Hi everyone, welcome to the podcast at the end of the day. This is me, Deepika, and my partner, Anuj.
And today we are talking to a married couple who are both medical professionals, Dr. Binu and Dr. Santosh, who are currently treating the patients of coronavirus in the US.
An interesting fact, Dr. Binu is based in, they are both based in different states. Dr. Binu is based in Connecticut and Dr. Santosh is based in Rhode Island.
And on today's episode, we're going to be talking to them about their personal experience of treating the patients of coronavirus amidst this pandemic.
Because of their professional etiquette, we are not mentioning the names of their institutions. Dr. Binu and Dr. Santosh, we are so glad to have you in the podcast. Welcome to our podcast.
Thank you.
For our audience, why don't you introduce yourself so that our audience know you better?
Yeah, starting from Dr. Binu.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Binu Raghu Barakoti. I'm internal medicine resident doctor currently working in Connecticut. I have worked as a government medical officer in Nepal for 2 years.
Hi, I'm Santosh Pilbase. I'm working as a practicing attending internal medical doctor as a hospitalist in Rhode Island.
We know that you have been practicing your profession in two different places, but today, coincidentally, you are together and we are doing this podcast together. How often do you guys see each other?
So he has 7 days, seven on work schedule. So we see each other like every week. So 1 week we see each other and 1 week we don't see each other. It's basically like that.
Okay. And Dr. Santosh, since we are doing this podcast focusing on coronavirus pandemic, how has this pandemic changed your personal life?
We don't socialize almost at all. No friends or visitors coming to us, or we don't go anywhere.
As healthcare professional, so how it feels is like, we are a little bit mentally and psychologically stressed with the fact that we work in the hospital, we see corona patients, and then like when we come back home, it's like, are we going to, spread to my husband or like my wife, or, the feeling of spreading to each other, or like, it's kind of a little bit stressful with that fact. And we have been like a little bit more alert, more cautious with everything.
And sometimes like when we take care of coronavirus patients in the hospital, come back home, we feel more scared. And sometimes we try to try to be away from each other, like try to keep some social distancing even at home.
It's kind of a little bit challenging in terms of like providing care to coronavirus patients. So the fact is we don't know much about coronavirus so far. We don't know about the disease progression, how the disease is going to act like in the next few months. So, and we don't know what exactly the best treatment is for the patients right now. I mean, like there are always, changing guidelines. Okay, do this for a few weeks. And now again, we are at the spot that, okay, we don't do that treatment again. So like it's changing guidelines. So we are kind of, we don't know what exactly is the best for patients. We're trying our best. So it's kind of a little bit challenging in terms of not knowing what the right course of action is right now. And also with the families, especially with the hospitalized patients, they're not able to visit their families. They're not able, and even the family members are not able to see their patients. And we have to act as kind of intermediating, person, and also be kind of emotional support to them. So it's challenging.
Yeah, it's challenging because the information that we know now may be outdated like in a week. So we have to keep updated like so frequently. And like the guidelines are changing. The thing we used to do like a week ago is no longer done. The medicines are changing. And the other fact is like all the hospitals have like no visitor policy. So we sometimes have scenarios where you have a patient who might be dying, but then you will be the only one by the side of the patient. Like even at their last breath, they can't have their family members at the bedside. And even the family members cannot get the body of their deceased family even until a couple of days after they pass away. So it's a little challenging now.
Right.
So does this all bother you?
Yeah, I mean, looking at the emotions of the patients themselves, it's like, okay, what might we have done that could have saved the lives of patients, you know? First of all, the thing is, we have to protect ourselves as well. I mean, it's not only the patients, we have to protect ourselves. We have to prevent us being the source of spreading to others. So that is one of the challenges. It takes a lot of time to wear all the protective gears and safely present ourselves to the patients. And also while talking to the patients, we don't know the answer for sure. Regarding treatment, we have to tell them, we have to provide support to them, and we have to have the positivity, but we don't know for sure if that is going to work for them. And the fact we are seeing with some of the patients is like, we don't know when the patient is okay right now, today. We think that the patient is stable, but we have seen a couple of patients that's they're so much like rapidly decompensate that we have no clue what happened, you know. So we have to deal with those situations. And also while rapidly decompensating, that needs a little bit more manpower, a little bit more, you know, and everyone has to dress up, and like providing care right now and then is again challenging at that point. And also family members, they are not able to see their loved ones in the hospital, and we have to like update them with what's going on, and again convincing them with the fact that, you know, which we also don't know for sure, is again, that is again challenging part. So, and that gives a little bit of stress to us as well, what happened, you know, like what might be the best thing for like the patients. So, and also protecting ourselves at the end of the day.
Yeah, so you just brought up protecting yourself. And we have been hearing so many news reports about how there's a scarcity of PPE, which is personal protective equipment, for health care providers like you. How is the situation right now? Like, are you guys getting enough PPE?
So far, I would say we have not been in the situation that we are posing risk to ourselves, but I would not say that we have enough resources that we can use, you know, like randomly how we were using before. We have to be very cautious about preserving the resources, because resources itself is limited, and there is like overwhelming flow of patients. So we don't know like how, again, the next 2 weeks is going to be like, because I think in every hospital, there used to be like one ICU or so. Every hospital has increased their capacity, you know, to 2, 3, 4 ICUs like that. So we have to be cautious about that fact, and with the limited resources, we are working. But I would not say for now we have posed ourselves to that position that we are like at threat, or, you know, like we are not having enough PPE, or we are not using the masks or gowns that we are supposed to be using.
So far, we have the basic supplies, but the thing is, the guidelines are changing so frequently. Like the PPEs that we used to wear, like say 1 month or 2 months ago, now because of lack of those resources, like even the guidelines have changed to some extent, saying that you don't need like the N95s for all the persons now. So far, like, they are changing the guidelines. Sometimes we are skeptic whether like these new guidelines are real or they are because we don't have enough resources. But yeah, we have the supplies so far, and it all changes with different states, the resources the state has regarding the testing and the supplies. And it also changes with like every week we go to the hospital. Mm-hmm. Some week we have abundance of supplies, some week like we are more like limited. It all depends like every week, and depending on like every hospital and the state.
Okay, now I want to switch our gear to emotional distress, especially healthcare providers like you are going through. And as we all know, we just had a news last week that a doctor committed suicide who had been treating the patient of coronavirus in New York City. Just wanted to know how you guys are coping with the emotional distress during this pandemic.
So yeah, I think everyone right now is in stress. I mean, every normal individual, and especially healthcare workers, the frontline workers are obviously in a lot of stress. There is like overwhelming work. You have to work like extra hours, and especially with all the like COVID patients, you have to dress up, and that itself takes like extra time, and also like with limited knowledge and limited, you know, treatment options available, you are like trying to do your best. That all puts you in a lot of stress, and obviously seeing all the patients, I mean many patients, you know, suffering and like dying here and there, it's not a good feeling, and that is obviously going to put emotional stress upon you. I think we all are in emotional stress, but I mean, we all have like our own mechanism to cope. So far, like what we have been trying to do is, trying to connect to our family members, loved ones as much as possible, speaking to them, like what we are facing. I mean, you know, like telling whatever like we experience. First thing, and second thing is like trying to limit the news, I would say. Seeing news here and there, like everyone out, that is just going to add upon stress. I mean, it's not going to change much on how much we can do to the patients, but it's just going to add upon stress. So trying to limit the news. And third thing is obviously something that gives us own pleasure, you know, like we try to make different items, food items, engaging ourselves in gardening, doing something like watching movies, lighthearted movies, distracting totally from this whatever is going on for like at least few hours. We have also started practicing yoga, meditation and relaxation techniques, at least giving 30 minutes a day to ourselves, you know, like forgetting everything and just relaxing. I think that kind of helps with the relieving the stress.
And also like in my hospital, we have like, since we have started like we're having the COVID pandemic, we have a different like committees where we can like bring out our stresses. And we have a lot of backup, like say I'm in any stress, I can ask for like, say physically, if I have a lot of work to do physically, then I can ask for backup to help me with that. And if I feel emotionally stressed, then we have different hotlines. We have like group meetings where you can share our stress or do something like online, like via Zoom, we can do like some parties or something so we can relieve the stress. And even like we also like recommend like suicidal hotlines. Mm-hmm. Say if you feel suicidal, then we have the hotlines. We can communicate. Like, so yeah. So far, we are trying our best, and it's going well so far.
Just a reminder for our audience that we are speaking to Dr. Binu and Dr. Santosh, who are both originally from Nepal. And the interesting fact is they are a married couple and they are practicing in different states. One is practicing in Connecticut and the other is practicing in Rhode Island. And today it's a coincidence that you guys are together in your home in Rhode Island and we get to speak. So during the moments when you are emotionally distressed after your duty hours, how often do you get to speak to each other daily?
So, I mean, we know duty hours of like being a couple, we know like when we will be working, you know, like 10, 12 hours a day. So at that time, like we are busy at our work and we don't mind even if we don't, you know, call each other or like text each other, like we are kind of focused on our work. But after that, we know like when we will be back home. So, I mean, we make our best effort to talk at least 30 minutes, 1 hour, you know, even if you don't talk. And sometimes we are so burned out that we are like, we don't have energy to express or talk as well. So at that time, we just we just call each other and like we just do whatever we are doing on our own and just speak here and there. But yeah, uh-huh. That's how like we have been connecting to each other.
By the way, what do you guys talk about these days?
So yeah, so we share our experiences, like every day, like something happens in the hospital, so we share with each other. So, yeah. And sometimes we can share our concerns. So the fact is, once you share something that's bothering like the mind, it's like we feel like emotionally relieved. And I think it like recharges us.
Yeah, though we feel, strong, but sometimes we both become like weak at some point, and you know, like and then that's when like when I feel a little bit weak or like when I'm constantly built and he kind of provides strength, he's like okay, no, don't think like that, things might be the other way or something like that. And when he feels like that, I do that part. So I think that's how like we have been coping.
And how often do you talk to your families in Nepal? And I'm sure families in Nepal are always concerned about, especially about us, because we are, America is right now the epicenter of the coronavirus. So how often do you talk, and what are their concerns?
So right now, I think the frequency of talking to families in Nepal has also increased because they are really concerned. You know, they see the data, they see people dying here in US, and they are so concerned, and especially us working in the hospital being exposed. So they are like calling, you know, almost every day or like at least alternate day and asking, is everything okay? And we will be answering like, yeah, everything is okay so far. So yeah, that's how, I mean, and we also try to provide them with some positivity, with the fact that, yeah, I mean, like we see a lot of cases, but people are not just dying. There are a lot of people that are actually, I mean, who are actually improving, and they are like actually discharged.
You said earlier that we are doing like yoga and meditation almost every day now.
Yeah.
So we are trying to do it in like a group chat. So we have like a couple of people, like 4 or 5 different people.
Yeah.
Like especially like different family members.
Different family members, whoever yeah. can connect at that time. So we try to do together in group so that we are like more focused and, you know, we have time to spend with each other as well. So.
Mm-hmm. And we are now at the end of our podcast. This question might be a harsh question to you, but I'm just gonna ask you, how do you feel about your profession right now?
So profession right now, I think, has been at its most challenging time. We feel challenged at times. We feel like burned out at times. But at the same time, sometimes we feel very nice as well. There is like some nice feeling in between that comes while you are providing service in the midst of pandemic, that gives you kind of a little bit satisfaction that you are helping when, you know, the help is actually needed. So it's kind of mixed feelings, I would say. I mean, like you are worried about yourself, you're worried about family, you are worried about everything that's going on. And at the same time, with the satisfaction that you are helping when it's needed. So you are at that position where you can do something to help to others. So I think it's kind of mixed feelings.
Yeah. And also like added to the fact that now we have like different like posters, play cards at places saying like you are our heroes, or and like in the hospitals, like we always get like some food like from some bakery.
Yeah.
They're like
it's like some gratifying, yeah, you know.
Yeah, like there's so many ways people are like appreciating that what we are doing. And also sometimes like I feel very happy, especially like when I'm talking to a family member who cannot see their parents or like their beloved ones, and I'm telling them, okay, they are getting better, and I'm like acting as intermediary, and like when they show their appreciation, like it fills our like heart with joy. And also like we are really passionate about our like the things that we do. That's why we are in this field. Like we have been in this field like more than like 10 years now. So yeah,
I mean, we see people improve as well as we see people die. So there is kind of, you know, mixed feelings. But at the same time, as you said, that when people appreciate your hard work, obviously that will give a little bit of satisfaction and okay, joy kind of feeling. So
Is there anything else you want to add to our audience?
The cdc.gov like has a lot of information. So if anyone wants to know more about like coronavirus, what's being done and the changing guidelines, then everyone like is encouraged to like look at the site maybe like once every couple of days, so they can update themselves about like what are the new guidelines that have been changing and how we can protect ourselves better at home.
Yeah, and lastly, not only with the mental health professionals, I have seen a lot of patients who are now being admitted with alcohol intoxication because of the stress out and depression as well. So I think everyone should ask for help when they think they need help. So yeah, please don't hesitate to ask for help.
It has been so wonderful talking to you both. Thank you so much for sharing your personal experience, you know, of working and providing service to the patients of COVID-19, and we really appreciate your time. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you for letting us share our experience as well. It was nice talking to you both. Yeah.
And we wish you a beautiful sunny weekend.
Yes.
Okay. So with that, we would like to thank you all for listening to our podcast and for watching our podcast.
And please Make sure you subscribe our podcast and share this episode.
So please stay safe and take care. Bye guys.
Hello, I'm Ian Hull from the U.S. Census Bureau. Beginning on March 12th, everyone in the country will be invited to respond to the 2020 census. You'll have the ability to respond to the census over the phone, online, or using a paper form. It is incredibly important that everyone is counted. Make sure you, your family members, and your neighbors are counted in this critical census. We only get one chance every 10 years to conduct the census. This is your chance to be counted.